Hello everyone and welcome to another With Electronic ISOS webinar. My name is Markus Eberle and I will moderate this webinar today. We are very pleased that you took the time to participate in our webinar. The topic of today's webinar is Bluetooth Low Energy, New Adaptions. Our speaker today is Matthias Hauser, who is working as software engineer in the field of wireless connectivity and sensors at With Electronic ISOS. He will hold today's webinar and also answer your questions. As we also take all possible steps against the coronavirus, we are unfortunately not sitting in the same rooms today, but are holding the webinar out of our home office. In case of technical problems or some delay, please take this into account. We will do our best to make a smooth process possible. Before we start the webinar, I would like to point out one thing. You will be muted during the webinar today. This means you cannot ask us questions via microphone during the webinar. Nevertheless, you have the opportunity to ask us questions during the webinar at any time via the chat function. You will find the chat function in the webinar control panel. The webinar will be about 30 minutes long. The chat questions will then be answered in a question answer session following the webinar. There will be 10 to 15 minutes in addition scheduled for this. If we are unable to answer all your questions within this time, we will answer them via email after the webinar. If you still have any other questions left after the webinar, just email us at isos-webinar@we-online.com. We will try to answer all questions promptly. At the end of the webinar, you will be asked to participate in a feedback survey. We would be pleased if you took the time to fill out the survey and help us to improve our webinars. Also, you will receive the link to the presentation as well as to the recording of the webinar only in the next few weeks. And now I will hand over to our speaker, Matthias, and I wish you an exciting webinar.
So thank you, Markus, for the introduction and also welcome from my side. We are talking today about Bluetooth Low Energy, especially about the new versions of it. So what's the content of today's presentation? First of all, I will give a short introduction into Bluetooth itself. Then we will consider Bluetooth Low Energy, and the main part of the presentation will be about the Bluetooth Low Energy versions and their most promising features. So what is Bluetooth? Bluetooth is itself, it's a wireless standard for simple and secure connectivity. It was invented to replace cables, for example, between PCs and peripherals, for example, printer devices, or between other mobile devices. It uses the 2.4 GHz ISM band that can be used worldwide free of license, so there's no charge needed for the usage of it. Nevertheless, Bluetooth itself gets licensing costs, but this has to be paid only once per product line. It's about $8,000 for a normal user or for a normal producer of devices. It has been invented in 1998 by the Bluetooth Special Interest Group. Bluetooth itself consisted first of the Bluetooth Classic standard, which you can see here on the left side. It has been under development until Bluetooth version 3.0. So in between, many features have been added that you most probably know. The pairing, for example, frequency hopping techniques, authentication, and also encryption things. After version 3.0, the development of Bluetooth Classic has been stopped. Most known applications of Bluetooth Classic radio are the HEDI profile, which is used for keyboard and mouse connection to computers, for example. Then audio profiles, A2DP is also most known because of, for example, your hands-free kit in your car or your Bluetooth speakers, for example. And in industry, mostly the so-called SPP, the serial port profile, is used. That, is used for data transmission of arbitrary data. All Bluetooth Classic versions are backward compatible. That means if there is a device that uses Bluetooth 3.0, for example, it can communicate with a 2.0 version. It uses 79 channels. We have a master to slave architecture, which allows one master to communicate with several slaves. Here, this master is controlling the lines or the communication to the slaves. That means that the master has to ask the slave if slave wants to transmit some data in the direction of the master. In the below image, you see a timeline of a Bluetooth Classic communication, which means that we have certain slots, and in each slot, a piece of data transmission takes part, meaning that either the master is transmitting data or a slave is transmitting data in the direction of the master. The effect of that is that in Bluetooth Classic, the devices are always working on the radio, meaning they are either transmitting data or they are receiving data, meaning that there's a high energy consumption. In 2010, a second part of the standard was added, which is Bluetooth Low Energy. We see here on the right side. At this time, development on Bluetooth Classic was stopped, and only improvements have been done on Bluetooth Low Energy side. The reason for inventing Bluetooth Low Energy was that Bluetooth Classic was not made for battery-powered systems. As I previously explained, the energy consumption is quite high, and if we are talking about future markets, especially the IoT market, the Bluetooth standard needs to cover such battery-powered devices. So, what is Bluetooth Low Energy? Bluetooth Low Energy versions are obviously also backward compatible. That means they work on different Bluetooth Low Energy devices work on the same amount of functions. And if there are functions of a newer standard, they have to agree to each other to use the new functions. Otherwise, they stick on the old functions. We have 40 channels available here. 3 of them are used for advertising, and 37 are used for data transmission. On Bluetooth Low Energy side, we also have frequency hopping and time synchronization techniques. The main difference to Bluetooth Classic is, we can see here on the image below, that within the interval, the Bluetooth Low Energy device goes to sleep mode in between. So it means in the first part of the connection interval, data is transmitted in each direction, either from master to slave or vice versa. And in the second part of the interval, the device is asleep. And that's the reason why energy consumption is somehow low. Profiles and applications. So Bluetooth Low Energy uses a generic language, I would say. It's called generic attribute profile, which is the abbreviation for it is GATT. Using this profile, predefined profiles are realized by the Bluetooth SIG, or they are, let's say, described in the standard from Bluetooth SIG. Examples for that are the battery service profile, which simply transmits the current battery charge, or a link loss service, which is another profile that simply sends a message if a link between two devices is lost. Besides such predefined profiles, there are also custom profiles, for example, the Ember SPP-like profile that we introduced from Wirth Electronic to replace the standard SPP, which you probably know from the Bluetooth Classic. The point here is that Bluetooth Low Energy has no standard profile that has such a function as the SPP profile on Bluetooth Classic side. Therefore, we invented our own. There are four roles that a Bluetooth Low Energy device can work in. The most important are the peripheral and also the central role. A central role, it's usually your smartphone. It means it's a role that connects or initiates a connection to another device. And the peripheral role is the role or the device that offers services and data that waits for such a connection request from a smartphone. Examples are, for example, a peripheral could be a sensor, and a central could be your smartphone connecting to the sensor to read, for example, the temperature sensor value. The remaining two roles, broadcaster and observer, are less used. Broadcaster is a simple beacon device sending beacons in a periodic way. And an observer is a simple device that just sniffs, so to say, for beacons. So, but yeah, what's the difference between the Bluetooth Low Energy versions? As I showed previously on a slide, there are several versions available. The first Bluetooth Low Energy version was 4.0, and the most current one, which was released last January, is the Bluetooth version 5.2. So what's the difference between them? Starting with Bluetooth 4.0, it was the first version that allowed only 30 bytes in a single radio packet, which is quite less. So that means the remaining or the resulting throughput of such a data transmission is really low. Furthermore, the output power was limited to 10 milliwatts to save as much energy as it can, just to support the IoT market. But we will see later, in later Bluetooth Low Energy versions, higher output powers are also allowed because the market shows that there are also other applications that want to work with the Bluetooth Low Energy, not only battery operated ones. Bluetooth 4.1 had some improvements. The most important improvement was that central and peripheral role was allowed in one device. Means that if you have one device, you can either initiate a connection to another device or you can accept a connection from another device. That was not allowed with Bluetooth 4.0. There you have to distinguish at development time if you want to accept connections or initiate connections. A next advantage of Bluetooth 4.1 is or was that many, many Bluetooth parameters have been made configurable, meaning that with this version, you configure the timing parameters, for example, of such a connection to the needs of your application. Yeah. To give you an example, I mean, either you can transmit data fast with a somehow high current consumption, or you can transmit data with a low current consumption, but then it takes several seconds to send them to the receiver device. So, and all these parameters you can configure beginning with this version. Bluetooth 4.2 was somehow a milestone because with Bluetooth 4.2, the data links extension feature was invented. With this feature, it was allowed to send data packets that are up to 255 bytes long. With this feature, obviously, the throughput increases a lot because the packets are 8 times longer than before. Therefore, the throughput also is 8 times higher. There are other features like more secure pairing modes, for example, the LESC feature. It's called Low Energy Secure Connections. There's one more important point. I marked it here in red. To be backward compatible, all or most of the new features are optional. That means if you have a Bluetooth 4.2 device, it must not support the data links extension feature, for example. It must not, yeah. We will see it also on the next slides. All the features are marked with optional. That's an important point. So they have not to be included in the device. The next version is Bluetooth 5.0, which was released with a high amount of Bluetooth marketing, I would say. The marketing says, okay, we have a faster radio and also long range mode. Now you can have double throughput and 4 times range. But that's not completely true. I mean, what was done is 2 more or 3 more radio modes have been invented. First of all, the 2-Mbit mode, which was in addition to the legacy 1-Mbit mode, which has double of the data rate, of course. And secondly, the LA coded mode, which is a long range mode, which uses 1-Mbit mode. That means in 2-Mbit mode, you have double of the data rate, but in LA coded mode, you have 4 times the range. So you have to decide to use either 1-Mbit mode, 2-Mbit mode, or long range mode. Therefore, you do not have double data rate and long range mode at the same time. But what does it mean, double data rate? Does it also mean double throughput? No, it doesn't. Double data rate means that a packet that is transmitted on the radio with 2-Mbit takes only half of the time. Yeah. But you're allowed to send only one packet per connection interval. That means the data or the amount of data you're allowed to send in a certain interval, it's the same. But the sleep periods are longer in between. Therefore, the current consumption is low. But the throughput is the same as if you use 1-Mbit mode. So that was somehow misleading marketing, in my opinion. The next version, Bluetooth 5.1, has the following main features. First of all, the gut caching, which is quite nice. I have to explain it a bit. If you set up a Bluetooth connection, the central device does a discovery of the characteristics of the peripheral. This is done during a connection setup. That means that takes time. What the gut caching now does is, at the first connection setup, the central saves the discovery data of the peripheral. And if you do a reconnection afterwards, it just reuses this cached data. And this means at the end, if you reconnect, the connection is much faster as before, because you do not have to talk that much during the connection setup. Second feature are some advertising enhancements. That means advertising channels can be resorted. Usually you have channel number 37, 38, 39. Now you can resort them as you like, just to avoid collisions on the radio. And the second advertising enhancement feature was the periodic advertising sync transfer, which just allows to synchronize all Brutal energy devices in time. This can be useful for some applications. On the right side, I mentioned the Bluetooth direction finding feature, which is the most known features of this Bluetooth version. It splits up in the angle of arrival feature, which is used for item finding applications, and angle of departure features, which is used for indoor positioning applications. We will now go into more detail about these two features because it's the most important of this new version. So the angle of arrival, what does it mean? There is a transmitter, a simple transmitter device with one antenna, which sends beacons periodically. On the receiver side, there is a receiver with an antenna array, meaning there are several antennas, at least two, maximum 75, that records the IQ data of the radio signal. And if you now consider the phase shift of the IQ data, which is received by each antenna, you can determine the direction of the radio signal. That simply means the receiver knows from which direction or in which direction the transmitter has been when it transmitted the data. Here on the right side, I showed such a device, how it looks like. That's a TI evaluation board, which has several antennas on here on the outside. There are six, one, two, three, five, four, five, six. So that could be such an antenna array that is used on a receiver side. So what is it good for, this angle determination? First of all, if you set up a positioning environment, that means you place some locators in your room. Each locator has several antennas, and each locator can determine the direction of the radio signal over tag, for example. You can estimate the position of the tag, meaning that each locator gives the angle of arrival to a location engine, which uses an algorithm that determines the tag itself. This algorithm uses triangulation methods and has to be somehow configured or at least developed by the system developer, meaning that depending on your environment, on the placement of your locators, on the position of your antenna, the algorithm in the location engine has to be adapted. So, but what does it mean? In ideal environment, as you can see on the picture on the right side, two locators are sufficient to give a good estimation of the location of the tag. Bluetooth says that in theory, a centimeter accuracy can be achieved. That's true. But in real environment, it's a bit more difficult. Meaning, for example, your office room, there are your colleagues that are somehow absorbers, because the human body absorbs radio signals, and there are some desk or some other metallic surfaces that work as reflectors, so to say. That means at the end, if you set up a system with a location engine and the algorithm included, you have to adapt the algorithm to the special environment you're using the system. The second method I mentioned before is the angle of departure method, which is the other way around, so to say. Here we have a transmitter device with several antennas. This transmitter device sends the beacons with this extension, with the direction finding extension, I call it. It's a constant tone extension, is the correct term. And additional information such as the coordinates of the transmitter. On the other side, there's a simple receiver that records this IQ data and does again the angle calculation. So for what is it used for? It's the application behind this indoor positioning system. If you consider this image here, it's somehow a 3D image, so to say. You have here a transmitter, this transmitter sends his location, this transmitter sends his location, and this mobile device determines the angle to this transmitter, the angle to this transmitter, and receives the location of this transmitter and this transmitter. It means for the mobile device, it's sufficient to calculate its own position in the room. So what is it good for? So imagine you are somewhere, I don't know, in your office, and you want to know the way to your coffee machine. Yeah. Then your mobile phone is able to calculate the position of you or of your mobile phone at least. And if it has a map of your office, also included a mobile phone, it can guide you the path to the coffee machine, as example. Okay. The most modern version of Bluetooth Low Energy is the Bluetooth 5.2 version. The main improvements of this version is the enhanced attribute protocol, which simply collects the data of several profiles in one message. That means if you have a device that has several profiles included, for example, a sensor that has a battery, and this device has the battery service included to tell a smartphone my battery level is, let's say, 50%, and it has the Amber SPP like profile included to say the mobile phone my temperature value is, let's say, 25 degrees or so. Then both information, the battery level information and the temperature value, can be sent in one radio packet. In the previous versions, it has been two radio packets, meaning if you now collect the data in one packet, you can save current because less radio packets are sent. The next promising feature is the adaptive power control, which simply is a feedback from the receiver side to the transmitter side to adapt its power. Yeah. If the receiver detects that the transmission power is much too high for himself to just receive himself or to get the range, so to say, it can tell the transmitter, please reduce your power, I'm still in nearness of you, so you can save some power. Again, here, the most important feature on the right side of this slide, it's the LE isochronous channel. That means data that you send via radio is now equipped with a time to live. That means with a timestamp. That means with this, time synchronized data packets can be transmitted via radio, and also time synchronized actions can be done on the receiver side. And this feature, the LE isochronous channels, is used with the new audio profiles that are called LE audio. We will consider this now. What is LE audio? As I said, LE audio is a new profile that uses the new feature of Bluetooth 5.2. What's the advantage of it? So first of all, you can do real multi-streaming with it, because you now can send time-synchronized data to each of the earbuds. Yeah, Before with Bluetooth Classic Audio, it was like that. The data was sent to one earbud, and this earbud relayed or repeated the data to send it to the other earbud. The effect of that was that the battery of the right earbud here was empty very quickly because it was receiving data and also transmitting data to the other earbud. Now, with LE Audio, we have two independent streams that are time synchronized. That means there is no relay between the two earbuds needed anymore. With this feature, new applications come up. Yeah, because now less energy is consumed, we can think about to equip hearing aids with a Bluetooth low energy radio. With this, you can connect, for example, your hearing aid to a smartphone or to a television. Another new application is the so-called broadcast audio sharing. Yeah, that means if you go to cinema, put your headphones on, and also the other visitors put the headphones on, there is a shared audio source that you can receive, or that all of the visitors can receive with their headphones. That can be used, for example, as I said, in cinemas or also in public halls, for example, in the airport. If they say, okay, the next plane is delayed by whatever, 15 minutes or so. But the main advantage of LE Audio is higher quality and less power consumption. What does it mean? If we consider here the standard classic Bluetooth Classic Audio, which uses SBC codec, in comparison with the new codec of LE Audio, which is the LC3 codec, low complexity communication codec, you see on the right side in this graphic that the perceived audio quality of the new codec is also high if you use low data rates. If you consider the old codec, if you reduce the data rate or the throughput or the data you want to transmit, the perceived audio quality goes down. Yeah, and I would say with the new codec, it's almost constant, almost. What does it mean? That means to have a high audio quality, it's sufficient to transmit only 192 kilobytes per second in LE Audio. Yeah, that means throughput is low or lower than Bluetooth Classic, and therefore energy consumption also goes low because the Bluetooth Classic device can sleep a lot in between. Besides of that, as I previously said, the audio quality, as you can see here, they did it with some standard stereo listening test. The audio quality in comparison to the Bluetooth Classic Audio, it's also higher. So it's somehow a win-win situation. Okay, that was all from my side. Thanks for the attention. Questions that have been placed during the webinar are answered now in the following section.
So, yeah, thank you, Matthias, for this interesting and really great webinar. As you mentioned, we would like to turn our attention now to your questions, and we wait a little until some questions come in. You have the opportunity to ask us via the chat function. You can find that on the right in the webinar control panel. So then we have a look at the first questions. And Matthias, there I see the first one. Do you know any development or, do you have any development or evaluation kits for your modules?
Yes, we have. the newest Bluetooth Low Energy module that you offer is the so-called Proto S3 module, which is Bluetooth standard 5.1. This module covers, I would say, all of the functions of the Bluetooth Low Energy except of the direction finding, which needs a new hardware. But nevertheless, for this module, it's the same as for other modules that you offer. There are evaluation kits, of course, available. There are SDKs available for host integration. And there are also USB dongles available that you can simply connect to your computer to enable a simple connection setup without any need for hardware development on your side, for testing at least.
Matthias, just a short question. What is an SDK? What it stands for?
SDK stands for Software Development Kit. Usually, our modules offer a UART interface on the cable side. And on this UART interface, there is a so-called command interface. That means you send commands via UART, for example, to do a data transmission or go to sleep mode or do a reset or do a configuration. And on the host side, if you connect your host controller to a module, you need to generate these commands to send them to the module. Depending on what you want to do, it's a bit of effort. And therefore, we decided some years ago that we do the work for you. Means we developed a so-called SDK, or it's called Wireless Connectivity SDK, which simply transfers high-layer functions into these commands. That means you get a piece of C code from us that has the functions transmit data, for example. You call this function, then this function generates this command, send it to the module. The module answers with another command, and this command is interpreted, and you just get a Boolean return value from the transmit data function. With a true, for example, for data transmission was successful, or for false, data transmission was not successful.
Okay. So then we see the next question. Matthias, how do you wake up the module out of the sleep mode?
Usually if you set a module into sleep mode, it's sleeping very deep, so to say. That means you use a certain pin as wake up pin to wake up again. That means if it's sleeping, you just apply a rising edge at the wake up pin and then it wakes up again.
Okay. So the next question, Matthias, using Bluetooth Low Energy is associated with paying for Bluetooth SIG licenses. Is it still an obligation for devices in which Bluetooth Low Energy is only a medium to configure for the implementation team and the client does not use it?
So it's like that. I mean, if you're in between, it's like that. If you're using the Bluetooth technology, you have to pay this fee. Yeah, it's the declaration fee, it's called. If you integrate a device or a Bluetooth device in your end device and you do not use it for any reason, there's no need for the fee, of course. But in case you use it, you have to pay it. It was different some years ago, but in between it's like that.
Okay. So the next question is from an attendee from software side. He asks us, what ASIC chips are available on the market which provides these profiles? Matthias, I don't know. Do you know which profiles?
No, but as I said, Bluetooth Low Energy uses the GATT profile, yeah, which is a generic language that I said before. That means all of the Bluetooth Low Energy chips support this language. And with help of this language, the implementer of Bluetooth code, yeah, or that is implementing the chip, the radio chip, can use this language to realize any profile. So there's no limitation. And there are many, many providers of radio chips on the market. For example, Nordic Semiconductor is the biggest one in Bluetooth Low Energy market. I mean, there are others, Texas Instruments, of course, ST Microelectronics, of course, and others.
Okay. Then we come to the next question, Matthias. How much data can a broadcaster send per package? Or let's say it in other words, what is the maximal data throughput?
Yeah, here we have to distinguish a bit. Broadcasting sounds to me like a beacon transmission. So here you usually have 31 bytes per 20 milliseconds. That's the fastest you can do. But that's not the the standard way of transmission. Usually you use a connection-based point-to-point connection. And with this, it depends on your configuration. Here we have on Proteus 3, our newest module, we did some tests. And what we did, for example, we used 2 Mbit radio, yeah, the fastest radio, 1 Mbit UART, the fastest UART, and the shortest connection interval of 8 milliseconds, plus a special feature that is only available on our Protoss modules. It's the so-called high throughput mode that sends 4 data packets per connection interval. As I said before, usually the standard case is that 1 packet is only sent per connection interval, but we enable the option to send up to 4 packets per connection interval. And with this configuration, we get a throughput of 370 kilobit per second. Yeah.
Okay.
That's the maximum what's possible.
Really interesting. Okay. Then, Matthias, next question. When will the first Bluetooth 5.2 radio modules with a low energy audio will be available?
Yeah, that's a good question. What I can say for sure is that end of this year, there will be the first chip supporting it. Usually, module development plus certification, all this stuff takes around about 1 year. We from Word Electronics will, of course, first do a pre-development before any module is finished, so to say. That means, first of all, we're going to check what the standard can do and if it's sufficient.
Okay. Then we have a look at the next question. And there is the next one. Matthias, what ranges can I achieve with the Bluetooth long range mode? Can I then establish a connection with the cell phone over 100 meter, for example?
Yeah, range questions. They always depend on the antenna and the antenna height. So what I can say is that we did some tests with our newest module, the Proteus 3, which has long range mode included, with an external antenna and 2 meter antenna height. We got a range of 750 meter, which is quite impressive. If you now want to reach this with your cell phone, it's somehow difficult. First of all, cell phones, okay, they state we are Bluetooth 5.0, but long range mode is an optional feature. That means usually long range mode, it's not included into cell phones. Maybe this will change in future, but that's the current state. Second, due to the small size of a cell phone, there is also a small antenna included, a small Bluetooth antenna included in the cell phone. That means with such an not optimized antenna, it's also not possible to get the best ranges. I'm sure 100 meter can be reached with a cell phone later on, but it obviously depends on your environment. I mean, if there are many houses or walls in between, you will have problems to get this range, of course.
Okay. Matthias, then the last question. If I use Bluetooth Low Energy only for debug and configuration, SIG licenses are not obligatory. Is Bluetooth Low Energy not core functionality of this product? So I think the question is here, if the configuration SIG license is obligatory.
Yeah, I mean, if you develop a product and also sell it, you need to have this license for sure. If you do some tests in your office or in your laboratory, it's sure not needed. Yeah. So if you sell a product, you need to have it.
Okay. So then we are finished with our webinar. If there are any questions open or left, we will answer them via email afterwards. So thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you enjoyed our webinar. Also, many, many thanks for you, Matthias, for this great webinar. I hope we will hear us at our next webinar, and I wish you a good day. Goodbye.